starting in 1900, roughly, particle physics has started. And it looks that we are, well, maybe we are at the end of particle physics. So maybe a little bit premature, but you can make a sort of a history of particle physics. And people know very little of it, and it's very, very interesting, I find. Also, I always have had discussions with people in cosmology. And sometimes I get angry and I write nasty things. And so I also have those nasty things, if you want to look at them. And so I have various things. I once was asked to give a talk on the possible origin of this universe and what we can say about it. Of course, we cannot say very much, but at least you can look to the science of particle physics with the prospect of what does it mean in our understanding of the universe. So that's another lecture I have. So I would make some selection of those lectures and do them next week instead of the rather complicated algebra that you are going to get now. So this is something for you to decide. It might be that I'm going away tomorrow because my wife is ill and she is in Madrid. But if that's not the case, I will come back on Monday and then we will do either, I can either continue with this or I can give you those two lectures in which you will be able to enjoy, I'm sure, and do it that way. This is something you can decide for yourself, okay? So let me first ask a very simple question, but I will verify that I get the correct answer. The lectures I have given so far, who has understood them? So we select somebody who you didn't understand them. You did? Well, let me do again today, do the normal lecture, and if you think you, I leave it to you. At the end of the lecture, I will simply put it to the vote. I will continue this series and wind up with complicated things, the standard model, the unitarity limit, and so on and so forth, things relevant for the physics that will develop when the LHC is switched on in Geneva, or I will give you some of these seminars of which I have a big box, and I'll pick out the ones that you might probably like most. I mean, this I can do. I'll put this to the vote at the end of the lecture today. Okay? Yeah. And after that, after I'm gone, you may hate me freely. Yeah? Okay. So, first of all, I'm going to skip this one, the Higgs model. It is not something that we, it's the simplest way. You remember so far, I have been talking to you about the implications of the cosmological constant, about in the vacuum there being something. If there is something in the vacuum, the only real way you can see, well, there are various ways that you can see it depending on what's in the vacuum. A priori, there can be something in the vacuum. There's all kinds of properties. Now, if you have something in the vacuum, for example, which is a vector field, it means there is something in the vacuum with a direction. And that will have a consequence for the way the universe is made. There could be a direction. Also, there is something else, just to tell you how these things can be. You see, when the universe was made, what happens? Nobody knows, because nobody was there. So we don't know what happened. But in any case, at the moment of explosion of the universe, somehow the vacuum must have formed. The vacuum, you might think of it as to what is in between the stars. So that formed at the beginning, at the very beginning, when there was the Big Bang, which we believe in. But this is a complicated issue. There might be something else. For example, it's possible that there are different kinds of vacua. This is quite possible. I will explain you in a minute how that works. And then it could be that perhaps when the vacuum comes about, not one is made, but this one is made here, but at a slightly different spot another is made, and so on. And so you get a combination of vacua, which after a little while would reduce to the vacuum as we know it, with maybe little spots in there which are a different vacuum. Vacuum bubbles, a little bubble, you could have that. At one point, we have speculated, I have together with somebody, on the idea that such bubbles could be what we call quasars. Quasars are things which are not understood at all. They are very funny animals. They have a mass. A quasar looks to us like a star, but they have a mass which is of the order of magnitude, well, maybe a bit smaller, as the mass of a galaxy. So it's not just a star, it's something comparable in magnitude to a galaxy. And further, it's marked by the fact that quasars burn, and they burn out. They have a finite lifetime. They decay. And the way they burn out is because it seems that they have two streams, jets of particles coming out on two sides of a quasar. So that's very funny. Nobody knows what's going on there. So you can speculate if you feel like speculating. Nothing is more interesting than speculating on what a quasar might be. And you could speculate that that's a vacuum bubble. So you can do that. You don't get very far because in astronomy it's very hard to get answers to specific questions. It's a matter of getting lucky and getting something that they have seen. But so it is conceivable that there is more than one vacuum, and that on the formation of the universe, more than one vacuum was made. And that means you have different regions. And how it works out, you don't know. But one idea would be that you have these regions that are like the magnitude of one galaxy of a different vacuum. Could that be? I have no idea. And such a region, in any case, if you had such a region, it would be unstable. After a while, it would, you know, decay into the other vacuum. And the way that works is like this. If you think of particles or fields having some state which is lower in energy, then that is what basically the vacuum becomes. I gave you the example of the cavity. So if you have a low energy state with an energy less than zero, a negative energy state, a bound state of fields whose energy is negative, then automatically when the universe formed, it will fall to that state, for sure. However, it might be that the situation is more complicated. This depends when you have fields interacting with themselves, there will be some sort of potential. You can make models for that. These things are well known, but in general, think of it that there is a potential which has a minimum. So there's two fields interacting, and they attract each other, so to say. So there's a minimum potential for these fields being in space. It could, however, be, these things can be very complicated. It could be that you have a potential which is like this, which has two minima. Then it could be that you have two possible vacua. Very likely one will be a little bit lower than the other, but still here and there this one will form and somewhere this one. And after you wait a while, of course, this one will tunnel to the other somehow, you think. So that's a model you can make, and it gives you an idea on the complexities that you can have. But I don't want to go too much into that. These are things which are very speculative, and it's very hard to think of any way of finding out if it happened or not. But the vacuum structure is a very complicated issue. Today, even if the vacuum structure is a very complicated issue, we see space between stars look empty. You see nothing. And the question of a direction, well, there seems to be a preferred direction in the universe. Recently, there were arguments for that. By and large, we don't see much of a direction. You don't see it in wherever you would expect it. So it seems whatever there is in the vacuum, it doesn't seem to have a direction. Yeah? It doesn't seem to have many other properties. You don't see nothing of it. And that leaves, you should well understand it, that leaves at this point, from an experimental point of view, very little possibilities of what there can be in the vacuum. You have to remember that. So, of course, the thing that we would not see, a field that we would not see, would have to be a field without a direction. That is to say, a field for a particle without spin, which means a scalar particle. So If we are going to put something in the vacuum, which we will do because we need it for the standard model, we must take a field which has no direction, that is the field of spin zero, a scalar field. You have to understand that this is not necessarily true. It could have been otherwise. It puts also a little bit of a perspective on getting such a field. It is a choice, but why precisely that one, we do not know. Actually, papers have been written on there being a field with a vector field in the vacuum or things like that, but none of these things has given any answer that is useful. So we assume, then, in order not to get into trouble, we assume that if there is a field in the vacuum, that it is a scalar field, one of corresponding to a particle of spin zero. And the first person who came with that mechanism, well, it is a bit complicated, but the one that we are thinking of is Mr. Higgs. And Higgs used it, I'll just tell you the history that you get some idea of it, and then we will go to directly to the relevant Higgs model for the stomach model, as it is in the stomach. The historical development of this is twofold. On the one hand, well, from my point of view, I never knew of the work of Higgs, and in fact, in Utrecht, where het Hoofd and I worked on these things, we reinvented whatever Higgs had done and others had done on the spot. Once you know what you want, it's not so hard, you see. But Higgs did it without a motivation of making the standard model, so that's another story. So his motivation was different. Now, why did Higgs do that? He did it because there was a development in solid-state physics. In solid-state physics, people tried to understand superconductivity. And you may know that at some point, due to the work of Cooper, who introduced Cooper pairs, I know very little of that theory, don't ask me too much. I know Mr. Cooper, but I don't know his theory. But that's that. So he had the idea of Cooper pairs, hypothetical pairing of electrons, an electron hole or something like it. And that, assuming that such Cooper pair exists, they could explain superconductivity. Now, superconductivity is a funny stuff. If you have a wire and there's a current going in there, yeah, and that current is superconducting, then that is a problem. And the only way you get a problem, because what goes on in that wire if this current can go there and become big, etc. Well, the actual fact, the way that has to work, if you think about it, I'm sure you can understand that. The way it has to work, that in the superconducting, things are going to sit very near to the surface. As you have a wire, and the current is going to sit very near to the surface, because if it's closer, it will push itself out. Yeah? So what happens in the superconductor is that somehow the electrons go sit very near to the surface, and the electromagnetic field of that you have there cannot extend very much, because that would give rise to big currents. So the electromagnetic fields, indicators of superconductivity, have a finite range. That's an essential discovery that was made in the theory of superconductivity. So to the amazement of the people who made that, the man who made that was Mr. Anderson. He made a theory there, and the statement was that the electromagnetic fields in the superconductivity have a small range. The fields. The photon field, so to say, at a small range. Now, in field theory, and of course everyone knew that, in field theory, if you have a particle of mass zero, the field associated with it is like the Coulomb field that drops with 1 over r. So the 1 over r dropping of a Coulomb field is the hallmark of a particle of mass zero. If you have a particle, so that was that exchange a particle, like an electron and a proton, or two electrons, then there is a potential between the two, and that potential is 1 over r, which is corresponds to that part of being like having a, in the Fourier transform of that is one over Q square, where Q is the formal that's being changed. So the potential is 1 over R, and that looks like this. Now what happens when you have a particle this mass being exchanged? For example, if you have an exchange between a proton and a neutron and you exchange a pion, this is the interaction that we think governs the attraction or the whatever between protons and neutrons in the nucleus, due to exchange of pions, then the pion has a mass. And so instead of 1 over R, you find 1 over R, but with an exponential cutoff, minus R divided by something. So if R gets big, this exponential cuts down the potential. So the potential in this case is like 1 over R, looks like this. But if you have a particle of mass, this I don't know where it is here. If you have a particle this mass exchanged, like the pion, then the potential cuts off as soon as this potential, this exponential becomes of order 1. But this is what's called the Yukawa potential. And Mr. Yukawa is the one who conceived of this idea, and therefore, because the forces among nuclei is a short-range force. It's no more than just the nucleus, but once you're outside the nucleus, you don't feel it anymore. So the strong interactions have a finite range. He knew about roughly how finite, and therefore he was capable to deduce the mass of the particle that was active in there. And so Mr. Yukawa predicted the existence of a particle, which then later was found to be the pion, with a mass roughly as predicted. And Mr. Yukawa. Okay, so that's this for the first time that Mr. Yukawa introduced here the potential due to the exchange of a particle with mass. Now, the same thing happens now with superconductivity. The electromagnetic field, if it has a finite range, but this is it doesn't go on like this, but it's cut off, which it was in the model. Using Mr. Cooper's pairs, then that means that the electromagnetic field has come over a finite range. That means that in a field theoretical sense, the electromagnetic field, the photons, had gotten a mass. So in the model of superconductivity, as it was known at the time, it was around 1965 or so, it came up that the electromagnetic field inside a conductor had a finite range and behaved as if the electromagnetic field, the photons of that field inside the superconductor, had a mass. And then Mr. Higgs and also Mr. Brout and Englert looked into that model and made from that another model imitating the mechanism of superconductivity, whereby they could create a situation whereby a photon has mass. And this is the original Higgs model. Mr. Higgs had a photon, the mass zero, he created additional interactions, something, and then out of that came a theory where the photon had a mass and electromagnetism of finite range. So after Mr. Higgs had done that, well, Brout and Englert did it too, people extended his work and eventually it led to the fact, to the real application, that weak interactions, which have vector particles but with a big mass, can be understood as results of a theory where originally they had zero mass, but then they acquired mass by this mechanism, which therefore is called the Higgs mechanism. Now I hope I'm being clear how from superconductivity, where there was a strange thing happening, how you got to field theory, and that was a step made by Higgs, Brout and Englert. Now let me explain the complications that you had here. And that is what you should understand. To give a particle a mass by means of putting something in the vacuum and let the particle travel through it, I've told you before, that is one thing.
All you have to do, you put something in the vacuum, and anything that interacts with the stuff that's in the vacuum requires thereby some potential energy, which you will observe like a mass. So that's, that part is easy. However, there is an additional difficulty when you deal with vector particles, like the photon, and that has to do with degrees of freedom. A photon is described by the electromagnetic field with four components, and so therefore there are four different kinds of photons to begin with, corresponding to the four independent directions that you can give this in you. And one speaks of, one speaks of the various polarization states. It's also known, and I'm not going to go that into detail, that of these polarization states, at least two are unphysical. Meaning that if you compute what the norm of such a state is, you get something negative out, meaning negative probability. You can't really handle that. Just for a photon. If you have a vector boson, a particle like the photon, that is with a mass which is not zero, which you describe by a field, also with four components, then there is only one which is unphysical. Now this, this feature makes the treatment of vector fields more complicated. And whoever follows a course in field theory and needs vector fields, like the electromagnetic field and the weak attraction field, will have to deal with this problem. And this problem is, you can read it in I also, I've written a book, you can read it in there, but of course many people have written it. I'm sure that Paco has written a book in which this described properly how you deal with polarizations. And this is not the time for me to start explaining that feature. But it is important for you to know that there is a difference between particles of mass zero and particles of non-mass zero, vector particles. And the difference is discrete. So please remember, a particle of mass zero is not what you can understand as taking the limit of zero mass of a particle, of a vector particle with mass. And the difference is the following. If you have a photon, there are only two degrees of freedom, the spin, and the spin is, if the photon moves in that direction, the spin can be aligned either in this way or in that way. Okay. These are two possible spin states. Now why is that for a photon and why is this not so for a vector boson, this mass? So if you have a vector boson of this mass and it spins in that way, then you can make a Lorentz oscillation. If you look to this particle, then you go jump in your car and you drive with your car in the same direction as this particle. And if you drive sufficiently fast, faster than this particle, then it seems that the spin is the other way. That is contrary to the direction of motion. So here, the spin is along the direction of motion. If I look through a car which goes faster than this particle, the particle seems to move backwards, but the spin is still like that. So, if you have a particle with mass, the idea of a spin along the direction of motion is not an absolute idea. You can transform one into the other by looking at it from a different point of view. So they have no independent existence. This is not so for a photon. If you have a photon that moves, of course, with the spin of light, speed of light, and the spin is aligned with it, you can travel as fast as you want, but since you never will, you will never go faster than the speed of light, it will always remain pointed in the same direction. So the idea that the spin is aligned with the direction of motion is a Lorentz invariant, is an absolute idea if the particle has mass zero. So a vector particle of mass zero has two such states, and they are independent, and you cannot transform into each other. They're different. They're just different states. However, for a vector boson, you have one such state, then this one exists also. And this leads to the important statement that a photon, as we know it, can have one or two independent states. And we think that our photon has two independent states, spin along or spin against the photon. These are the two polarizations of the photon. You know that light allows two polarizations. However, for a physical particle, a vector boson, it can be like this, it can be like that, and it can in fact also be like that, which means that you make a rotation. So in short, for the photon, for the electromagnetic field, we know that it has two independent, can have two independent spin states, while a vector particle, which you can put at rest, a vector particle you can put at rest, so if it's here, and it's spin, if it's there, you can turn in any of three directions. When it is at rest, just by a rotation. So a particle of spin, if the mass of a particle is non-zero, meaning that it moves with a speed less than that of light, you know that there are three different states of spin. So now comes a very curious feature. If you have a thing like the electromagnetic field, like you saw in the superconductor, it has initially, if there is no superconductor, the electromagnetic field has only two states of polarization, 2 degrees of freedom. You can have this or you can have that photon. So 2 degrees of freedom. If you have a vector particle, it has 3 degrees of freedom if it has mass. So what happens to the photon when it was massless and then it gets a mass? You're talking about particles with a different number of degrees of freedom. Instead of 2 fields, you must work with 3 fields when it gets a finite mass. So here is the very curious thing, and that is what Mr. Higgs and so on worked out. When you have a particle, a vector particle, that used to be without a mass, to refer to a particle, vector particle without a mass, and when that becomes massive, when it gets a mass, somehow or other, there must also be a degree of freedom extra coming in. Okay, now this is the crucial point of what we call the Higgs mechanism, the providing of a new degree of freedom to the vector particles, so that it can have 3 degrees of freedom. And there is some mechanism there, that's what we call the Higgs mechanism.
Well, let's see if
so the original Higgs model, what happened is that Mr. Higgs had the electromagnetic field described by this here, that's d mu a mu minus d mu a mu. That's the well-known Maxwell Lagrangian for the electromagnetic field. Then he introduced another field called the K field, which had 2 components, a real and an imaginary part, but otherwise it was without spin. So the field K had no further degrees of freedom. There were just 2 components, a real and an imaginary part. And so then Mr. Higgs did a certain amount of work. He made sure that this field K, that you would get it in the vacuum. So he constructed an interaction of that field with itself. That's here, this interaction, a four-point interaction. So that there would be a state of lower energy than zero. He made it currently in the vacuum. And so I won't go into details, which you can look up if you wish, because you can have these lectures. What he created, that is the potential that we were talking about. What he created there is a potential, it had a minimum. And so that meant you will get the field in the vacuum.
Now, Higgs' situation was a quadratic field. Well, I should explain to you this feature. This, as you see, the field K is quadratic, is the real and imaginary part. So K star K, that's the absolute value of K. If I make a plot of K in the two-dimensional plane, is imaginary and a real part, the only relevant thing is K star K, which is the length. So the plot that I'm making here, the potential as a function of K, where K is complex, I really should see here as circular. Okay. Am I clear? I have shown here only the real part of K, the complex part of K is takes you out of the screen. And so what you have is that you take a K and it has a real and a complex part that you can compute what this is. And K star K equal to F0, that's where you get the minimum. Cannot get anything less. That is what you get at this point. Or if you rotate, you can think of this rotated, yeah, and that is a curve that you get. And anywhere along that axis, K star K has the value F. But it doesn't tell you how big the real and the imaginary part are separately. Okay, it tells you only something about the length, K star K. And that is a very specific feature also of these things in connection with field theory, with standard model, because you see originally you have a symmetry. You are invariant for K getting a phase factor. That you would have seen on the previous page. If you give the field K phase factor, phase factor, since everything depends on K star K, that phase factor would never make a difference. So the Lagrangian is invariant for whether you speak about this K or the K which get, you get by a rotation in the complex plane. K star K. So you have therefore an invariance for this transformation. Now, what happens now is something very peculiar. We say, of course, the field will go in a configuration that it sits in the vacuum. So when the universe is created, it will put the field K in the vacuum, such that you get into this minimum, that's the lowest energy state. So you get a configuration with some K. But you see, nature there makes a choice. Because nature has to say whether he takes a K that's here, or anywhere on that circular path. And at the moment that nature has made that choice, the situation looks different, and it seems that nature has chosen a certain direction in K space. It's important that you remember this, because I will come back to that and give some criticism on work that was done in another context, and it is important to know that. Yeah. So, nature, at the moment of the Big Bang, chooses a vacuum. It chooses a K. Which one, we don't know. They all have the same energy. Yeah. They correspond to that minimum there. But which one, we do not know. One of them. So we call that the direction of the vacuum, you could call that. It's not the real direction in the sense that you could see it, but it means it chooses a direction in the space of K, of its real and imaginary part. And why am I saying this? It is because in another context, you will get to deal with people that, you know, people, serious, if you are not careful with them, always do additional things. And so, for certain reasons, people have started to use more models like this, but with more of these K fields, so not just one, but several. Yeah. And then there comes an issue that if you have several such K fields, then the nature may make a combination of all these Ks going into their minimum. Yeah. But you see, while one K may be this one, somewhere on that circle, for another K, that may be another direction. And so you get to deal with an important concept, that means the alignment of the vacuum. And the alignment of the vacuum has come to play an important role in what is known as strong CP violation. So I want you to remember that. If you introduce more than one system K, is a field K, it may be that nature, when it makes a choice, does so a different one for this as compared to that one. And that may introduce funny angles. In fact, what happens in general, I can even tell you at this point without being very complicated about it. Usually, to describe a particle of charge, if you have a K particle, that's normally a particle of charge, a charge. So a particle such as this one here normally interacts with electromagnetism, interacts with photons, in an amount defined by how that you write it down. So a complex field in general describes a scalar particle of charge. The charge is simply the degree of freedom associated with the real and imaginary part. Yeah. Then what happens is you have one such K particle, and the direction that nature chooses, the proportion of real and imaginary part of nature chooses, the direction on that circle, determines what is zero charge, because zero charge is what the vacuum is. Now, if you have two such systems and the one is not equal to the other, then what is zero charge for one cannot be zero charge for the other. And that means that if you have more than one such system, you will generally have to deal with the fact that there will be a vacuum. We will come to that, so you don't have to understand everything, but you will have to deal with the situation that the vacuum gets a charge no matter what. Either it is a charge from the one or a charge from the other. There's a relative difference in the two. And in practice, that works out to the fact that the photon cannot be massless in a vacuum with charge. You cannot have a massless photon. That's also a little bit like in superconductivity. The photon gets a mass. So this is this illness that you can get if the vacuum are not aligned, is that the photon gets a mass, and it is that's bad, because the photon has no mass, as you know. It is a long range field. I wouldn't see you if the photon had no long range. So we'll come to that later on. I want you just know already to get an idea of what sort of complicated things that are going on. I'm going to skip this whole business, because there's not much point in looking at it. It's all very complicated. I'll just tell you the conclusions. First conclusion, number one. When you go to the vacuum, just like in the case of the tadpole, you get an extra constant, and that's the cosmological constant. So you do get a cosmological constant. It's somewhere here. I don't know where, somewhere here it is. So once you get this field in the vacuum, you get for free the cosmological constant, which is the real thing. So first of all, you get the cosmological constant. And from the way that things are going to be in the standard model, you will get the cosmological constant, which is predicted, and which is very, very big on the scale of things. Secondly, there is the unitary limit, heavy Higgs. This has to do with the fact what happens when your Higgs get very heavy. And what happens is the following, you can see that here, but I will not go into details. Here that what you get here is some particles interacting with each other. Some of these interactions will be proportional to the mass of the Higgs particle. So a very curious feature of these things is that you get an interaction between particles that depends on the mass of the Higgs particle. And if that Higgs gets very heavy, the interaction becomes strong. So what happens if your Higgs becomes very heavy, if you take the Higgs particle to be very heavy, the Higgs particle is that scalar particle that you will find in the vacuum. If that particle gets to, if you make it too heavy,
you will find out that you have strong interactions, new strong interactions. And the way to tackle that is through a mechanism that's called immunitarity, which I have not discussed. And then that will be what you have, and that could be. Yeah. So maybe that the Higgs particle associated with the standard model, which the LHC is supposed to see, if they do not see it, or if it comes out differently, it might be that there's a strongly interacting system and you get a whole complicated mess when you start investigating it. That could be. You have to be prepared for that possibility. So the heavy Higgs is definitely something that could be. You will generate a cosmological constant, and here you can make a calculation. And the calculation, this comes out here, depends on the parameters of the model that you have provisioned. The model has parameters lambda and mu, etc. And one of them becomes the mass of the photon. So in this model, you do get a vector particle, which now is got on the mass. You have what's called the Higgs ghost. I'll explain that to you in a second. It has a mass equal to the vector motion. You get the Higgs particle itself, which has a mass little m, an assumption that I won't talk about altogether. It's called the Fourier-Topalov ghost. You have to the question is, something funny has happened here. Because I told you that the massless photon had 2 degrees of freedom, while a massive photon had 3. Well, what happens is that you have this two-component Higgs field, a real and imaginary part, K as a real and imaginary part. Now, one of them becomes a ghost. What does it mean? It means that you don't see it anymore. It's there in your Feynman rules, but it's no more there to be observed. Instead, that ghost is there only for calculational purposes, but instead, in fact, you can get rid of it altogether. What you get back for that is the third degree of freedom for the vector field. So this Higgs mechanism, is, that's why I included it in the talk originally, is a model whereby you can see that you start off with 2 degrees of freedom, massless vector field, and a scalar field with 2 degrees of freedom, a real and imaginary part. Now if you have done your work, 1 degree of freedom has sneaked over from here to there, and you are left with 1 physical particle and a vector field with 3 components. In this model, it can be seen very easily, but I want to skip it because I don't have enough time. So now then finally there's the equivalence theorem. And the equivalence theorem is what is left over from the fact that 1 degree of freedom of that field here has sneaked over to the electromagnetic, to the vector field. We can perhaps understand that the interaction of this thing here, of this field, will be equivalent to the interaction of 1 degree of freedom of the vector field. That's the equivalence here. It tells you that 1 component of that massive electromagnetic field is equal to the interactions of the Higgs fields. It's a remnant of that statement that this has happened. That's called the equivalence theorem. And the equivalence theorem is very important for the following reason. If you can say that the field which becomes a vector field, which gets mass, if you can say that third degree of freedom is what it gets from the scalar field, and if you can see, therefore you can say that the scattering and all kinds of other interactions of that third component of the vector field will be equal to what the other field has. And then you can go back to the beginning, throw away the electromagnetic field, and study the interactions of these Higgs fields, the K field, with itself. And thereby you understand that 1 component of that field is going to be the vector field. So by studying that original field, you can get an idea of what the vector field will do. This equivalence theorem helps you therefore by looking to just the scalar field without looking to the vector field and telling what happens in certain cases. And the certain cases is what happens at very high energy. So for this reason, you look to study the high energy behavior of only the scalar particles, you can translate that in what will happen with the vector field. And this will allow us to make a statement
what possibly at the LHC can happen if we have very high energy vector bosons, because they will scatter in a way that we think we know at very high energy, like scale particles.
So that equivalence theorem has become very important in predicting what happens there. Its importance is derived also from another fact, which we will come to know. So then there's the cosmological constant. I told you about it, and I told you enough about it, so forget about it. Skip this too. Now I'm going to use the sigma model. The sigma model is a little bit more complicated than what we had on the previous case. In the previous case, I was talking about that K model, that K particle, and it had very simple interactions. K to the first term and K squared term. You see what I started off from? You have a K star K, a sporadic term, and a fourth order term. It's a simple start of symbols. It's enough to study certain aspects of the Higgs system, but it's as I see, just a simple case. But there's another model, which is very good if you understand precisely what we're talking about. It's the sigma model, which was discovered or introduced for the first time, if you don't
mind, sit for a second.
It was discovered by Schwinger. Schwinger used it in another context, but he is the inventor of this model. And that model essentially looks like this. You have four fields phi labeled by the index I. So the fields phi I equal 1 to 4. And this is the Lagrangian. You have a quadratic term and you have a fourth order term. What could be more simple than this Lagrangian? Four fields. Now this model has the most wonderful structure. So look at it and first admire how simple it is. There's two constants here for the quadratic and the quadratic term. And that's it. And it has four components. You can think of as a field phi, if you want to think about it that way, as a vector in four-dimensional space with four components, I belong to four. So this field looks a bit like you're talking about a vector in four-dimensional space. And sometimes you get the fake feeling that maybe this stuff has something to do with all the ordinary space and Lorentz invariants. If you think that way, and I can tell you that's a false way, don't do it. Yeah. You are against that, Tony? No, oh, I'm sorry, it's not you're against. But then I forgot you were always against. I forgot. So look at it, how simple it is. You have a vector of phi, a four vector. You take the square and the fourth and the square of the square and two parameters. Now, it looks a little bit like you are talking about Lorentz invariance with a four vector, so you get the same thing. You have an invariance. This Lagrangian, which as far as phi is concerned contains only the dot product of phi with itself, is therefore invariant for rotations in this four-dimensional space. Yeah. So we have four vectors, we have a four vector, and the whole Lagrangian will be invariant if I transform phi into itself by means of a rotation, if I consider it like a rotation in four-dimensional space. That's wonderful. This symmetry, the Lorentz invariance, of course, has the force component is imaginary. Remember, you have a minus sign in the metric or whatever, depending on how you do it. So this sigma model has four fields and it has an O4 symmetry, meaning you are invariant for orthogonal transformation in four dimensions. Normal for orthogonal transformation is one that leaves the length of the end, or leaves the end product the same. Yeah. And since it depends only on phi square, also here, it's contracted the index I. Yeah. This Lagrangian is invariant if you rotate, if you apply the transformation, which is one of the O4 symmetry. So this is the simple symmetry that you can imagine here. How simple.
rotations in four dimensions. Orthogonal transformations, real. They are real transformations. The field psi is real. Yeah, it's not complex. But ordinary four rotations, like Lorentz transformations, except there is no I in the first component.
So that's the symmetry of the sigma model.
Now I'll show you something. The sigma model I can rewrite in other ways. In advance it looks like it has other symmetries. And that is the devilish thing with this sigma model. It's very curious. Let's first notice the O4 symmetry is a six parameter symmetry. You have six independent parameters to describe rotation in four dimensions. That's like Lorentz transformations through which you can do work with ordinary rotations in three dimensions. And then you get Lorentz transformation, which is like a rotation involving the time t, like a rotation. Okay? So Lorentz transformation are through rotations, or rotations that involve the first component, time, yes? And these are the transformations to systemless velocity. So it's two sets of rotations in three dimensions. So a rotation in three dimensions has three parameters. You can specify a rotation in three dimensions by three parameters. That's namely, first you have to give its direction of axis that you rotate over. That's two parameters, at this angle and this another angle. And then you have to give the magnitude of the rotation. So three angles define the rotation in three dimensions. Therefore, a Lorentz transformation, which is like two already said, has six independent parameters. Just remember, it's good to keep that count, because if we are doing things, we must remember that in the end, there is a symmetry here which has six free parameters. Okay? Jesus Christ. Did somebody do something to the clock?
You have still something like 10 or 15 minutes.
I'll take a little bit more from the next time, yeah.
I'm sorry, this is a very interesting thing. I will rewrite the sigma model in a number of ways, and you will see different symmetries coming up, and you learn a lot from that. Yeah. We know that we have a six parameter symmetry. We start writing it in another way, we'll find other symmetries, but different ones, and they look otherwise, but we make sure that there are six parameters left, and we know we have the full symmetry content. But I have been too slow and too lazy. Yeah. Okay. So hopefully I will tell you that next or Monday. Now first I'm asking, now making a vote here, you remember, I have to take a vote. I continue in this manner, it shall be an officer. All kinds of things, most of which you can study by getting the notes, which you can get from private distillation, or from the famous Maria, and this is on this computer, it should be not difficult. So what do you want me to do next week, to begin this on Monday? Will you want me to continue this, or do you want me to give you a somewhat different seminar? This might be easier in the sense that you can just sit lazily and watch. Can I have a vote? Who wants me to go on with this? Jesus Christ. We had a name for that kind of people when I was in military service. The sergeant would ask, and who is going to help me? And afterwards we would of course beat them up. Yeah. Okay, I've learned my lesson. I'll continue this way, and maybe we will do that some other day later on and you get fed up with it. So what I'm going to do next is rewrite it a different way. You will get an understanding of the symmetry content of the sigma model. This then is put in the standard model. It gives you an idea of the symmetry content in the standard model. And among others, what you will find is the standard model looked at it in one way, is like this, and then in another way, it's like that, but then you realize there is some more symmetry that with the other way of writing you didn't see it. So this feature that one and the same thing can be written in different ways, one of the ways, and in fact that's the way it happens, one of the ways actually shows less symmetry on the face of it than you originally had. Not six parameters, but only four or something like that. Then you know that there is some hidden symmetry.
And in the standard model, this has played a very big role, because there is a hidden symmetry, and that hidden symmetry, if indeed that was the correct Lagrangian, usually prescribes, fixes the ratio between the masses of the charge and the neutral vector motions. And then comes an interesting question. What happens in the standard model when you measure these masses? Are they according to this hidden symmetry? And they are. And this is the this is a very important feature of the standard model. This thing is usually described by a parameter called the rho parameter. And we will start to understand what it means that the rho parameter is 1. And that deviations from that can be understood or can be used very well of understanding other fields. Among others, deviations in measurement of that parameter will enable us to determine the Higgs mass, if it is there. So it's very important to understand that. So knowing these symmetries here is an important feature. So we will continue that the next time. Thank you. And if there are any questions, please go ahead. Yes? Oh, there's him again. He knows the answers already. That's the bad thing about it. You tell me you don't know the answer to the question you're going to put?
Sorry?
You don't know the answer to the question that you're going to put?
Okay. The comet connected heavy Higgs with a strong interacting symmetry detector through the unitarity particle. Why? I understand the connection.
No, but that goes like this. The Higgs particle, I don't know its mass. What happens if that mass is very large? I find that certain interactions in the standard model become strong interactions. Because some of the interactions has as a coefficient the ratio of the mass of the Higgs and the vector boson. So if that ratio becomes big, just look at the Feynman rules. Certain interactions become strong, notably the interaction of the Higgs with itself, but also the interactions of the vector bosons with themselves. So certain interactions get strong. If interactions get strong, you may get resonances. If you have two vector particles which get very strongly attracted to each other, they may form a bound state. You get a resonance.
How do you know they form a bound state?
Well, they don't form a bound state, they make a resonance. And so the question of studying if and when they would form such a resonance is one of the things you can do. How would I know that? That's what I would explain, how I would find out about it.
But that doesn't say anything about the nature of the symmetry breaking signal. Tell you that necessarily this
Higgs has to be formed by. Well, if I see, for example, that my rho parameter experimentally comes out like I am having it here, that's a strong boost for believing I'm doing the right thing. But as long as we don't have the Higgs, I'm not sure I'm not doing the right thing. We should always approach that with all kinds of doubt. But you have to be careful. There are certain things that, you see, when you have a Higgs system, there are two kinds of consequences you can get from that Higgs system. The first kind of consequences may depend only on the symmetries of the system, but not on whether this particle is 1 GeV or 100 GeV. So such consequences are there, it's the rho parameter, and it turns out we understand that. Yeah. Now there may be other consequences, which are called dynamic consequences, which depend on the detail of how heavy this particle is and what interaction it has. Of these things we know nothing, experimentally.
What's the connection between unitarity?
So far nothing, but that's a usage of words which has made its entrance in the business, but has no base in reality. It comes because of the fact that what we can calculate usually is only the lowest order. And if the theory has a small coupling constant, then that's usually enough. But if the coupling constant becomes big, the other orders do matter too, and then the lowest order taken by itself doesn't give you any more a unitary theory. And so you have a unitarity limit. The unitarity limit is what happens if the higher order terms become as big as the lowest order terms. And it has been named that way because you discover that the diagrams without higher orders do not give you a good theory. It lacks unitarity. Yeah. It is sort of a misleading name. I can't help it. People did it, give the name without asking me. I would not have given them permission.
Any other questions? Maybe a naive question.
Yeah, I hope it's a stupid one.
I'm sure it's stupid, but
sure.
According to the equivalence theorem,
yeah,
the interactions of the longitudinal part of the Higgs bosons,
yes,
are the same as the original interactions of the Higgs field.
Well, only not exactly the same. A bit more complicated, but in a certain limit they are the same. Mm-hmm. This is the high energy limit.
So now you take a Higgs boson, which has a given polarization.
It has no rate moment. The Higgs boson is a scalar, it has no spin.
A Higgs boson.
A Higgs particle is a scalar particle, it has no spin.
I mean, if you take a photon, a massive photon,
yes,
okay, with a certain polarization.
Yes.
And then it has some interactions, and you make a boost, the interactions will change.
Well, but that's why I say it's only approximately true, only in the limit, because the longitudinal component of a vector field is not a scalar thing. Mm-hmm. You can rotate it, right? So that's not like a scalar particle. Mm-hmm. And so there you have an approximation, you have to go to the limit of infinite momentum. But of course, things will already be true long before you're at infinity. So it is an approximate something, this equivalence theorem, it's an approximate statement. You have to distill out of the theory something that is not violating the
variance.
Yeah, right. Yes, you have a problem. You have a problem for sure, but you don't know which one. No. Any more questions? Problems? Difficulties? Difficulties with your husband, your wife?
So let's thank Professor Wilman again.